Welcome to episode number 82 of Week in Review. My name is Sean, and on this week's show, we're going to talk about Them That Follow. We're going to eat some chips. We're going to talk about The Kitchen. We'll look forward to this week's new releases, and I'll tell you about the streams happening over on twitch.tv/Shaunosaurus Rex. Our first movie this week is Them That Follow, and I can't remember exactly where I saw a trailer for it. I was flipping through my notes, and I think it was at The Art of Self-Defense, which matches because they're both, like, smaller indie movies. It doesn't matter where. It's just, like, my brain sitting there and going, like, you have to figure out where you saw this trailer. Like, you had to have to. Aha, it's driving me nuts. Anyway, I think I saw the trailer at The Art of Self-Defense, and it looked interesting and intense, and that's what you get. It's led by a terrific cast that includes Walton Goggins and Alice Englert, and in the two leading roles, Walton Goggins plays a pastor of a church that veers a little bit more towards the, like, weird culty side of religion, and Alice Englert plays his daughter, and they are both just terrific in their roles. And the daughter has a secret that's revealed and starts to kind of tear the congregation apart a little bit. The great performances don't stop there, though. There's a layer of supporting performances that are absolutely fantastic. Caitlin Denver, who is in Booksmart, plays Alice Englert's characters, whose name I'm forgetting. What I thought was her sister initially, but they're just, like, best friends. She's very good in this. I'm just glad to see her on screen because I really liked her in Booksmart, and she's great here. Olivia Colman and Jim Gaffigan. Yes, the stand-up comedian Jim Gaffigan is in this movie, which is completely bizarre. And I remember that caught me off guard in the trailers where I was like, is that Jim Gaffigan? I was like, there's no way he's going to do this type of movie. He's like, he's a stand-up comedian guy. And I thought, like, maybe it's just, like, a look-alike. He just happens to look like Jim Gaffigan. And then, like, as the trailer ramps up, it's, like, showing all these Academy Award winner, Olivia Colman, Academy Award nominee, blah, so on and so forth. And it's, like, Jim Gaffigan. And I went, huh, that is really weird. The movie's strength is its performances. Like, I liked all five of those people that I listed. I think they all do a very, very good job in their roles. They're all engaging and interesting, and even if you're, like, screaming at the screen going, what the fuck are you doing? It still is engaging and intense in a way that I haven't experienced in a movie in quite a while. My big knock against this movie is kind of the overall plot. It takes a long time for this movie to get going and to put the pieces into place, and then it starts to kind of build towards its big climax. There was a large chunk of the movie where I was just kind of confused about exactly what was going on. We don't really get enough backstory as to why these people follow Walton Goggins' character, because he doesn't really seem all that charismatic, and he doesn't seem like he's leading by fear either. Like, it just seems like he has this group who are religiously devoted, and that's just kind of how it is. The movie also a couple of different times gives extracurricular plot points, but never really follows up on them in an interesting way. It doesn't come up towards the end when things are building towards its intense climax, and it kind of just feels redundant. The best example I can think of this is there are two characters that are driving down town to town for something. I don't know what they're going for. And a cop pulls up behind him, and one of them remarks, like, oh, they're after us again, or something like that. And it's kind of inferred or implied later in the movie that the cops had been there before, and, like, something seedy maybe happened, but I don't know what that is. And so it doesn't really play into the overall plot all that much. But then even the plot detail that it gives, where one of the characters, after the church gets broken into, gets taken into custody for a week, all it does is show the devotion of that character to the church. But we already know that through, like, several other examples throughout the movie that are a little more tightened to the plot. And it's a super weird thing where it's an unnecessary piece of information that doesn't add anything, and it's redundant. So it's like this weird thing where essentially all it does is it removes one character so that they aren't a problem for someone else for, like, 20 minutes of the movie or about a week's time in the plot of the film. And it's a super weird thing where I'm sure this happens a lot in movies where certain characters are placed in specific spots to remove characters to make scenes flow and plot devices continue to go. But in this movie, I noticed it a lot more than I normally would. Even if the movie is a little bit slow in points, it still does effectively build to a very intense climax. Even if one half of it, so it's like two things happening at one time, one half of it is, like, understandably ridiculously over the top, where I'm sitting in the theater going, like, what the fuck are you doing? Why are you doing it like this? But because of the rules that have been established in this movie, it, like, makes sense where you're like, I see what you're doing. You're an idiot. I don't know, like, your thought process is completely wrong about this. All you have to do is look over at this in one singular different direction and do the simplest thing in the world, and you don't have to do this terrible, terrible thing that you're about to do. On the other hand, we get a largely symbolic sort of resolution to one of the character arcs, and it was fine, I thought. Like, it took me a while to figure out exactly what it meant, because it's very wordless and intense with close-up shots involving snakes, which makes me uncomfortable because I don't like snakes. And when things happen, the movie kind of just ends, and I sat there and I was like, well, that was kind of dumb. Like, I guess it landed in an okay spot, but, like, and then as I was kind of walking around, as I usually do, it, like, clicked into place of, like, oh, X meant this. Okay, fine. I'm finding this movie to be a little bit more difficult to review because, on the one hand, I liked the way it built up the intensity, and the climactic finale was, like, 50-50, like, good and bad. Like, one of them was just so ridiculous. But on the other hand, like, I liked the symbolic nature of the other ending. I thought it ended in a weird spot. It took a little bit too long to get going, and I think that this movie's calling card is its performances. But it's a hard movie to recommend because it is, like, just, it's, like, dark and just dreary. Like, the movie starts at, like, happiness level 4, drops down all the way to, like, happiness level, like, negative 8, and then maybe ends at, like, happiness level negative 6.7. Like, it's just, it's a bleak movie that gets bleaker before it marginally gets better. And it's, I don't know, it's interesting, it's engaging, it's unnerving, it's weird. Like, I like aspects of it, but it's a really hard recommendation. And I can tell that other people don't really care about this movie either, considering I was the only person in the theater for roughly 40 minutes, which is including the previews, when someone trudged in with the loudest footsteps I've ever heard in a movie theater, just thump, 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 which startled me because, of course, at that point, there was a scene going on where somebody was like, hey, you know what you should do is you should take this stick and walk up into those rocks over there and then, you know, kind of dig out the leaves and see if you can find any snakes. So I was already intense, and then all of a sudden clomp, clomp, clomp comes into the theater, and I'm like, oh my god. They sat there for about 5 minutes and then just left, and I never saw them again. I can't imagine that's a movie you can walk into 20 minutes late. For the second week in a row, I saw a movie that made me need to decompress after viewing it. This more on the intensity side of just, like, just calm down and relax. Everything's fine. It was just a movie. You're all good. Thankfully, Lays was able to help me with that yet again this week, and it's not as bad a flavor as it was last time. This time, it's deep dish pizza, and I'm actually looking forward to trying these. The other flavor was disgusting, so you know what? Can't go anywhere but up from here, you know what I mean? Like, we're at zero, maybe like a negative one. You can't see my hand. It's given like a little level, you know, we're zero, negative one. It's got to get better, right? It has to be better. This can't be worse than the last chips we tried. I will, you know, do this. Hey, there it is. So let's crack them open. Oh yeah, give me that crinkle. Give me that good crinkle. Oh yeah. Oh yeah. Okay, those smell pretty good. They smell like pizza. That's a good start. I mean, to be fair, the other ones smelled grotesque. That's right. They tasted. I'm just gonna go back to smelling the bag now. I'm driving myself nuts. I wonder how much more or how much different these are going to taste than the Pringles pizza chips, which mainly taste like marinara sauce. Hopefully these have a little bit more of like an actual pizza flavor that's not just one ingredient of it. Give me a little cheese flavor in there, you know what I'm saying? It tastes okay. I don't know. So judging by the picture, it looks like it's just a basic pepperoni deep dish pizza. Just based on the picture. I think I can taste a little bit of like the pepperoni spice. You know, sometimes you get like a little, some companies, depending on which pizza place you go to, some of them have like spicier pepperoni than others. These are much better than the pickle ranch, the deep fried pickle ranch chips that I tried last week. To the surprise of absolutely no one, because those were absolutely disgusting. These are good. They have a very heavy marinara flavor. There's a little bit of a kick of like a spicy pepperoni in the back, but there isn't like much of like a cheese flavor to it. So if you like marinara sauce, try these out. If you're looking for something that actually tastes like a full-on deep dish pizza, these might leave a little to be desired, but they're not terrible. They're not great, but they're fine. They're fine. They're just I'm trying to make sure that I don't get overly excited, right? Because the last batch was so bad that I don't want to overrate these on accident because they aren't, how do I say this, making me want to vomit. So there you go. There's the best compliment. You can put it on the bag, Lays. Here, I'll put it right there. I don't want to vomit eating these chips. There you go. There's a free quote for the bag. They don't put critic quotes on bags, but you can if you want. So there you go. Deep dish pizza, whatever quote I said earlier. They're pretty okay. Now that we're relaxed, we can talk about The Kitchen, which is a movie that's based on a DC Vertigo comic book, which is like a Vertigo is an imprint of DC. DC's like, hey, here's Batman, Superman, all that stuff, and then Vertigo is like they're like, here's a bunch of weird shit, which would include this comic book that's set in the late 1970s in Hell's Kitchen, New York. The movie stars Melissa McCarthy, Tiffany Haddish, and Elizabeth Moss as three wives who have to kind of pick up the pieces after their husbands get put in jail for a crime that they absolutely did commit. Like, this isn't like, oh, it's a mystery. No, like, they did it and they show it on screen. It's a fairly simple plot. After the three husbands are arrested, they take over, they expand, they recruit, they become the new, like, head honchos. And it's a pretty interesting, like, rise to power. I liked the way all the characters bounced off each other. I thought they played well with each other, and I don't know. I just thought there was an interesting dynamic between the three of them. I don't know. The movie's nothing special, honestly. Like, I came here to watch this movie because I wanted to see Tiffany Haddish and Melissa McCarthy continue to expand outside their typical range. They both knocked it out of the park. I thought Tiffany Haddish was particularly good. She plays kind of like the brawn aspect of the three. So it's like she would be the brawn. Melissa McCarthy's character would kind of be the brains aspect of it. And then Elizabeth Moss's character is a little bit of the wild card. But they aren't strictly just relegated to those roles. They get to kind of overlap here and there. Like, even though Tiffany Haddish's character is like tough and like not taking any fucks, she's really smart about when she applies this sort of stuff. She's not out there just beating the shit out of people going like, this is my turf now. Like, she knows exactly when to pick her moments to gain the advantage and be better than the people around her. And I thought that that was really interesting. She is the best part of this movie. I liked her so much. She's the most difficult character to like watching because she is so ruthless. Like, there are times where you're like, damn, do you really have to go like that far? Do you have to be that mean? And then something happens and you go like, yes, you had to go that far and you had to be that mean, and I am sorry for ever doubting you. There are a couple of plot details that I didn't like. There's a romantic element between Elizabeth Moss's character and some guy who literally just shows up one day. It gives them an excuse to understand how to like hide bodies essentially, but it doesn't really fit anything else. Like, they try to make a romance out of it. I didn't think it really worked. There's also a little bit of a twist at the end that I did not like because I don't think they showed enough for me to be able to understand that there was something else potentially at play. And I thought it felt kind of cheap in a way where it's like, oh, and this happened. And I went, oh, but they didn't. All right, like, whatever. Like, it's not the biggest deal in the world, but it is right towards that end part where it kind of convolutes things in a way that I just felt was unsatisfactory. But on the other hand, it does show, how far they've grown, how far they can reach, and whose pockets they can get into. So, I mean, there is that aspect of it, looking at it from the other side of, like, here's how far they've come, here's the example of that. So, that I understand. I wish there would have been a little bit more of a hand tip somewhere to be like, oh, watch out for this. But it's not really there. I enjoyed watching the movie. I don't think it's not blowing the doors off of my life. I'm not sitting here ranting about like, oh my gosh, it's the most amazing thing in the world. But I wasn't bored or disinterested at any point. There were things that I wasn't the most thrilled with, but that's okay. And I walked out going like, hey, I had a good time and I enjoyed the movie and I'd like to read the comic book. Finally on the show, we'll look forward to this week's new releases. I'll make this short and sweet. There's nothing on Blu-ray. There are no games. And then there are three movies out in theaters. Where'd You Go, Bernadette, starring Cate Blanchett. Blinded by the Light, which is based on a true story inspired by the music of Bruce Springsteen. And Good Boys, which is basically Superbad but younger. As for the streams happening over on twitch.tv/Shaunosaurus Rex, I'm going to be checking out the Train Sim World DLC on Thursday. It's like a new update, and then they're releasing something that takes place on the west coast of the United States, so I'm going to check that out. There will also be a stream on Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, but I don't know what games I'm going to play, because I've been very indecisive lately. Thank you so much for watching this week's episode of Weekend Review. If you like the content, scroll on down and hit that subscribe button. And if you like the content enough, you could even scroll on down and leave me a comment below, and you can let me know what you thought of the kitchen, or these Lays that are sitting over here, the deep dish pizza Lays, or you can tell me what you thought about Them That Follow. Be sure to check out the streams on Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday over on twitch.tv/Shaunosaurus Rex. Don't forget to fill out your bracket on Challonge, that's challonge.com/SeptMascotMadness. That's SEPT as in the abbreviation for September, because the tournament starts on September 4th at 6 p.m. And be sure to check back every Tuesday for more Week in Review. We'll see you next week.